So very good morning to all of you. We welcome all of you to this basic course in astronomy, the module 1 introduction to stars. And this course is offered by Professor Sarita Vick and organized by Breakthrough Science Society in association with Public Outreach and Education Committee of Astronomical Society of India as a part of the science popularization program aimed at generating interest in basic science among students and also to inculcate scientific temper in the society. So we'll have a very brief inaugural session. Afterwards, we'll be formally starting the class. And to conduct this session, I would like to invite Dr. E. Srikumaran, Executive Committee Member of Breakthrough Science Society and also a faculty at the University of Calicut. Over to you, Dr. Srikumaran.
Thank you. A very happy morning to you all. Today we have assembled here for the basic course in astronomy module 1. And I welcome Professor Sarita Vick, who is the program instructor, and Professor Soumitra Banerjee, who is here to inaugurate this program. And this is being conducted by the Breakthrough Science Society in association with Public Outreach and Education Committee, Astronomical Society of India. This is to popularize science programs and to generate interest in science. Now for the inaugural address, I invite Professor Soumitra Banerjee, Professor at the Indian Institute of Science, Education and Research, Kolkata, and also the General Secretary of Breakthrough Science Society to formally inaugurate this program. Over to you, sir.
Professor Banerjee, I would request you to turn on your microphone.
Thank you, Professor Srikumaran, and good morning to you all. As you know, the Breakthrough Science Society, its main objective is to propagate a scientific bent of mind among the people in general and in particular among students. And one of the important media that we adopt to cultivate a scientific bent of mind is exposure to astronomy, the objects in the sky. That is something that we see, and we have been seeing, the humankind has been seeing right from the dawn of civilization. Yet, the actual scientific idea about what these bodies are, regarding their movement, their positions, these things have for a long time been shrouded in mystery, and that has often created a lot of unscientific beliefs, even superstitions. And so one of the ways that we feel that we should try to inculcate a scientific bent of mind is by giving a proper idea about the bodies in the sky. There are professional astronomical societies, professional astronomers. At the same time, there's a very large body of amateur astronomers. Those who watch the sky, they take interest in knowing about the sky, and not only that, using reasonably moderately powered telescopes, they have often contributed to fundamental knowledge in astronomy by locating comets, locating meteors, and things like that. So the Breakthrough Science Society is organizing this program, and I congratulate the Kerala chapter for taking initiative in doing so. It's doing it so that we are taking advantage of the pandemic situation when most of the communications are online. Otherwise, this would have been restricted to Kerala only. but we have taken advantage of that and reached out to the whole of India. And I can see from the audience that they actually come from all over India. And this is a, I look forward to the outcome of this training program, the workshop, so that a majority of those who will be attending, attend it seriously, really try to learn, and then they propagate those ideas in their own neighborhoods, among their friends, among their own circles, so that proper scientific idea about the astronomical objects propagate in the society. I don't have much more to say today. The main speaker will give you the idea about the astronomical objects, the stars. With that, I will end here. I wish you the best through the course of this course. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Soumitra Banerjee. Now I would like to give a small introduction about our course instructor, Professor Sarita Vig. She did her PhD in physics from the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Mumbai, and her postdoctoral research at the Observatorio Astrofisico di Acetri, Firenze, Italy. And currently, she is a professor at the Department of Earth and Space Sciences at the Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, Tiruvannamalai. Her research areas are astronomy and astrophysics, and specifically, she works in the area of early phases in massive star formation. And Dr. Sarita Vig is actively involved in popularization of science and is closely associated with Breakthrough Science Society. She is acting as the National Astronomy Education Coordinator in India to liaise with the International Astronomical Union. She is also a member of the Public Outreach and Education Committee of the Astronomical Society of India. With those words, I invite Professor Sarita Vig to take over the session. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Srikumaran, and thank you, Professor Soumitra. Indeed, it is a pleasure to be here, and I'm happy to be here. It is a series of lectures, and I hope the initial excitement which all of you have shown will be continued throughout the series. At the outset, I would like to thank the Breakthrough Science Society as well as the Astronomical Society of India for helping with the organization of this program. So, without any more ado, let us begin. Give me a moment to share the screen. So I hope my screen is visible.
Yes, madam.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so today is the first of the series of lectures where we will be talking about introduction to stars. And there will also be examinations, as you are aware, and a few assignments, and these will be duly communicated to you through email. And regarding questions that you may have, I advise that you please note them down in the chat box. Since there are many participants and we have limited time, I will try to address a few depending on the time that is available, and I will try to address the rest and get and communicate them appropriately to you. So today we will be talking about an overview of the cosmos, which is in a sense an introduction to astronomy. Of course, we will be learning about stars throughout the rest of the lecture series. But yeah, it is a good idea to get an overall view of the sky, a brief view. So as we begin this journey to the stars through the sky, there are some things that I would like to tell you what astronomy is not about. First is that it is generally assumed that an astronomer trains. If you want to become an astronaut, then you need to train in astronomy. That need not be the case. An astronaut requires a completely different kind of training. And an astronomer need not be an astronaut. Usually, it's a very technical training that is given to an astronaut who are either engineers or pilots and so on. The second is, this is also a kind of, myth that people have, that if you say you are an astronomer, they assume that you can tell them about their future, which is not true. We study astronomers. When I say we, I mean astronomers. We study the sky. We look at the cosmic objects and we form scientific theories based on our observations. Using that, we can predict the events in the life in the lives of stars, but we do not predict events in the lives of human beings. So an astronomer is not an astrologer. With this, I think we are all set to go and to talk about astronomy. So astronomy is the study of cosmic objects in the universe, as all of you are aware, and our tool is the telescope. Using the telescope, we get a closer, better view of the sky. We can see objects much more clearly with more detail than what we can see with the eye, and that helps us understand the more about these objects. So the first question is, why would you like to study stars? Of course, as you look up in the sky, the sky appears has very mysterious ways of working, that there are these stars which are twinkling and we want to know more about them. So stars are these fundamental luminous units in the universe, and we want to understand more about them. And when we look them up in the sky through our eyes, we see a large number of stars. So obviously we are very, very curious to understand more about these objects, what are stars, and a lot of details. And hopefully this course will give an introduction so that you get more familiar, and the next time you start looking at the sky, you get a better understanding that you know some bit more than before when you started off with the course. Okay. So there's another interesting reason, I think, why we need, it is useful to study stars. Of course, this is more from a perspective, a novel perspective, that where did we all come from? I mean, where did Earth come from? Where the what is the Earth made up of? What are we made up of? So the composition. So when you talk about the compositions, the first thing that comes to mind, of course, are the elements. But then we can ask more fundamental question. Where did these elements come from? Correct? So apart from hydrogen and helium, all the elements are synthesized in the interior of stars. So that in itself is a very novel idea. So all the elements that we know, they are produced in the interior of stars. And we will be touching briefly about the production of these elements and how they get distributed. Now, if they are present in the interior of stars, then how does it get distributed? Okay, there are events and there are phenomena by which the material, processed material, or these heavy elements can get distributed into the medium from which stars are made and planets are made. And of course, on planets, we humans are made, and so on. So ultimately, the elements, if you really want to go to the very fundamental aspects of where did these elements come from, then we need to understand the stars. We need to understand how these elements are produced in stars and so forth. So this is an periodic table. I'm sure all of you are very familiar, but this is an astronomy periodic table in terms of the element origins. So as you can see, they are color coded. Hydrogen and helium are like cosmic origin, the elements which are present mostly in the universe. And then you have a number of elements which are either produced in exploding massive stars, exploding other kind of stars called white dwarfs, merging neutron stars, dying Roma stars. I'm not sure at this stage many of you may be fully aware of what these other terms are, although you may have heard neutron stars and white dwarf stars, what is a massive star, what is a Roma star. But hopefully by the end of this course, you will be familiar with this terminology to a larger extent. But what is important to note here is that we understand that these elements are produced in different phenomena in the occurring in the sky. It is not that it is oblivious, and that has happened because of the persistent and consistent efforts of a lot of astronomers working in tandem in order to understand the workings of nature and the workings of the universe. Okay, so now if you look at the expanse in the universe, the vast sky that you are familiar with, we are all here, located here on Earth, right? And then Earth is a part of the solar system, right? And this solar system comprises of sun and a number of planets and other objects which are bound to the sun. And this solar system is part of a large, very large aggregate of stars, which is known as the galaxy. Our galaxy is the Milky Way galaxy. And this Milky Way galaxy is one of the, it's not the only galaxy, of course. We have more than around 100 billion galaxies maybe there. But this may is a part of another group of galaxies, which is known as local group of galaxies. And this local group of galaxies, which means the galaxies themselves are present in the form of certain groups. Galaxies are together in the form of certain groups. And our group in which Milky Way is present is known as the local group. And this local group by itself is part of a local superclusters, which means even these groups of galaxies belong to certain clusters or superclusters of galaxies. So Milky Way is part of a local group, and the local group by itself is a part of the supercluster. So, and there are many, many such superclusters. So this is the vast expanse of the universe. And here we are present on Earth trying to decipher this working of the galaxies, the universe, and how it all began. Okay, so we will start locally, very very much close to us. First and foremost, I'm sure all of you are very familiar with the solar system, right? So these are our bright cosmic neighbors, right? Of first is the sun. The Earth is moving around the sun, Earth and all the planets. And we also have another bright companion, which we see at night in the sky, which is the moon. So moon is a natural satellite, which is revolving around the Earth. And this Earth-Moon system is revolving around the sun. The path that the Earth takes around the sun is slightly elliptical. It's not fully circular. But on an average, we can calculate that. But that ellipticity is very small. So you can we can say that it is a very small ellipticity, almost a circle. But if we were to calculate the distance between the Earth and the sun, that will not be constant. But the average distance is given by this number, 1.5 times 10 power 11 meters. So, and this is equivalent to one astronomical unit. So one astronomical unit is 1.5 times 10 power 11 meters. I believe somebody's video mic is on. Can you please mute? Yeah. So 1.5 times 10 power 11 meters. So in astronomy now, as you will be seeing, we will be talking with really, really big numbers. So every time if you want to estimate the distance to a particular star or distance between stars, you will have to talk in terms of these large numbers. Therefore, we define units which are convenient in astronomy at the astronomical scale. So one AU is one such unit which is commonly used in astronomy. This is known as an astronomical unit. And this is the average distance between the Earth and Sun. And this is the typical value of this distance. So as I said just now, there are different distance scales and you can have different units. For example, if a very small unit, you will measure in different, that's why you have different units, right? You have a femtometer and you have nanometer and then you have centimeter. So it depends on what you are measuring. If you're measuring very small objects, you will use a unit appropriate to that. But we are of course in the larger domain, right? So we have talked about astronomical unit, for example, which is, and this unit is usually used to measure the scale of the solar system, for example. And then if you want even larger units, because this is a very small unit, as we have seen just now, this is a very small unit compared to how big the universe is, and you want to measure distances at much larger scales, then you will start using slightly different units. And another common unit is the light year. So the light year is the distance which is taken by light to travel in 1 year. Okay, so you can easily do this calculations, the speed of light multiplied by the time in 1 year, that will give you the distance. And you see that it is of the order of 9.5, 10 power 15 meters. So one light year is this given by this unit. This is a very simple calculation, and I'm sure all of you can do this. Then there is an alternate unit, which we will also be coming to soon. I will just introduce it for now, and later we will see how we define this. So this is known as a parsec, okay? And this is equal to 3.086, 10 power 16 meters. We don't often use light year, rather we use parsec because it has a physical significance in terms of how we measure the distance between objects on the sky in terms of angles. So how a parsec is defined, we will come to soon. But at this point, since I was already introducing the various units of distance, I thought it appropriate to just include this here now. Okay. So now that we have seen what are the units of distance, let us look at units of mass. So as we know, if you start measuring the mass of Earth, mass of Sun, mass of Moon, they will go into 10 power 23 kilograms, 10 power 24 kilograms, and 10 power 30 kilograms, for example. So those are very, very large units. So therefore, when we are talking about masses of stars or other bodies in the sky, in the cosmos, we tend to use not kilograms, but rather units which are useful in astronomy, in astronomical terms. For example, you can measure the mass of stars with respect to the mass of the sun. So the mass of the sun is known as a solar mass, and it is given as 2 into 10 power 30 kilograms. And here, as you see, we use this kind of notation to denote mass of sun. Sun is denoted by this circle with a dot in the middle. This is a symbol that astronomers use for to denote the sun. So when you write the mass of the sun, one solar mass, so we will not write solar mass entirely like this, rather we will write solar mass in this term. Then you can also write in terms, if the mass of objects are smaller, then you can write them in terms of the Earth mass. So the Earth mass is given by 5.9 times 10 power 24 kilograms, and the symbol of Earth is a circle with a plus sign in between, enclosed. So as you can see, the relative sizes, one is of course the mass. Now let us look at the relative sizes. As you can see, the sun is so many times bigger, maybe 100 times bigger than the Earth. And you have different planets. You can see the relative sizes of these planets. And if you want to measure the sizes, then again, one can use either the Earth radius or the solar radius. When we are talking in with regards to stars, we usually again use the sun as a standard, and we write one, so the radii of stars in terms of the solar radius. And this is given, this one solar radius is given as 6.9 into 10 power 8 meters, whereas Earth radius is 6.4 10 power 6 meters. Now we have seen about the what are the units used. Let us look at our solar system. So what is our solar system? Our solar system comprises of sun and other celestial objects which are gravitationally bound to the sun. That is how we define the solar system. So what are these objects which are gravitationally bound to the sun? And why do we say they are gravitationally bound to the sun? Because the sun is the most massive object in the solar system, and it influences, it has a gravitational influence on other small objects moving around it. So there are 8 planets with their known moons. Currently around more than 200 of these moons are known, of which I believe at this stage more than 170 are confirmed, but there are a few which are unconfirmed. Then there are some objects which are known as dwarf planets. Now, dwarf planets, I hope all of you may know that a few years back, Pluto was very much a planet, but now it is no more a planet. So Pluto is now considered as a dwarf planet, Okay, we'll come to in a bit about this. So there are objects which are dwarf planets, example Pluto and Ceres. And other than this, there are billions of small objects which include asteroids, comets, meteoroids, Kuiper belt objects, interplanetary dust, and so on. And this picture here, for example, shows the sun and the various planets in order of the distance from the sun. Then we have an asteroid belt, which is between Mars and Jupiter, and this dwarf planet Ceres, which is located in the asteroid belt. There is Eris. All these, Eris is also a dwarf planet. Makemake is a dwarf planet as well. This is good. These are Kuiper belt objects. Now, what is a dwarf planet and why was Pluto demoted, for example, from being a planet to a dwarf planet? It so happened that with better telescopes, better technology, we were able to, look and detect more objects in the nights, detect more objects in the solar system whose sizes were comparable to Pluto or even larger than Pluto, and they were moving around the sun. So if Pluto was categorized as a planet, then they should also be categorized as a planet. This is what astronomers thought. And then since this was a big problem, they at the Congregation of Astronomers, which is known as a meeting of International Astronomical Union, they had a very interesting discussion about this. And then they said, okay, we will, instead of having more planets in the solar system, because with time we may discover further and further objects which are moving around the sun and whose mass may be bigger than Pluto, they decided to redefine what a planet is or what a dwarf planet is. So a dwarf planet, for example, orbits the sun and is not a moon. Okay, so it orbits the sun directly. It is not moon of any other object. It has enough mass to assume a nearly round shape. That's why asteroids are not dwarf planets, because they do not have the round shape. So if you have enough mass that it becomes a round shape, then it is a dwarf planet. And thirdly, it is a dwarf planet is one which has not cleared the neighborhood around its orbit. Okay. So if you look at the definition of dwarf planet versus planet, a planet satisfies all the first two conditions, but it has cleared the neighborhood around its orbit. So a planet has cleared the neighborhood around it so that other small objects are not present around it, whereas that is not true for dwarf planet. A dwarf planet can be part of the asteroid belt and there are small tiny objects around it, or even in the Kuiper belt. Okay, we'll come to this aspect later. So Eris is the largest dwarf planet and it is in the Kuiper belt, and it is not even as big as Moon. Okay, so it is 22% of its mass is 22% of the mass of Moon, and its size is around 67% of the size of Moon, which means it is smaller than the Moon. It is a dwarf planet. But the Moon is a moon because it's a natural satellite of the Earth, even though it is larger than the dwarf planet. So the largest dwarf planet is Eris. So this slide, for example, shows the solar system here, as you can see. So this is the Kuiper belt. As you can see, it is like a disk with the sun here. It's like objects distributed in a disk or a belt. That's why it's known as the Kuiper belt. The solar system this is the orbit of Pluto, the dwarf planet. And this blue line here, till here, you have the solar system Neptune. And the Kuiper belt extends up to 50 times the distance between the Earth and Sun, which is about 50 astronomical units. And what is the Kuiper belt made up of? It's made up of a large number of tiny icy objects, okay? Because they're very far from the sun, so the temperature is very low, and therefore these objects are icy. And it is believed that this Kuiper belt itself is embedded within a very large cloud, which is known as a Oort's cloud. So this is a hypothesis that astronomers have come forward. So you see the small blue thing, elliptical object which you can see here, that corresponds to the Kuiper belt, and that is a part of this. That is the Kuiper belt. Within the Kuiper belt, you have the solar system here. And this large cloud is the Oort cloud. So it is believed that the solar system extends up to the Oort cloud. And what is the size of the Oort cloud? The size of the Oort cloud is estimated to be around 100,000 astronomical units. Okay, so this is the extent of the solar system. Now there's another question which you may be having. There are planets, we have talked about planets around the sun, but are there planets around other stars? Have people found, for example, planets around other stars? As a matter of fact, yes, they have. And the first of these was in 1992 discovered, and later it was first proposed that there were two objects moving around the pulsar. Later confirmed them to be exoplanets, and now people have been studying these exoplanets for so long. These exoplanets have been being studied for so long by various techniques. They are being studied, and this is one area of active interest and research currently. In fact, there are space missions which have been sent in order to study the planets around other stars. So exoplanets are, or extrasolar planets are planets around other stars, and nearly 4,000 to 5,000 of them have been discovered and are currently known. What is shown here is an artistic representation of one of the exoplanetary system. I'm just showing you some examples, introductory examples. This is the Kepler-62 system, and Kepler-62 is the star, and around this, it has been found that there are a number of planets which are moving. Like there are five planets. They are, so 62A, Kepler-62A will be the star, and B, C, D, E, and F are the exoplanets around Kepler-62A. So Kepler was one of the missions to detect and confirm the presence of planets around stars. What is shown in green here is the habitable zone. This is also an area of a lot of interest, because according to us, an habitable zone represents that area where around a star where life could persist or be present. For comparison with Kepler 62 system is the solar system which is shown here. And importantly, I want to again emphasize that what is shown here, we cannot see the details of these planets as it is shown in this picture here. This is just an artistic representation. At best, what we can do is we can get indirect signatures of the presence of planets around stars. And how many planets are there? So that is the outcome of rigorous study of observing the stellar system. Then there is another system that I want to quickly show before we move on to other things, and that is the TRAPPIST-1 system. So this TRAPPIST system, for example, is of a size which is similar to the, not exactly similar, but of the same similar scales of the solar system. So this system, for example, will be in a small region around the suppose you were to try to fit this size into the solar system, then it would be much smaller than the size of the solar system itself. Here, of course, the type of star at the center and the one that we have in our solar system, the sun, are very different. So people are also trying to see what are the kind of stars around which planets are being hosted and whether there is scope for life to be present, shown as green here. Okay, so here, for example, seven planets were discovered around this TRAPPIST-1 system. So what do you mean by habitable zone, this greenish region? As I said, when we say that we expect life, we look at it from the perspective of life on Earth, and we say that the distance from a star at which liquid water could exist on the orbiting planet, for example. It's also known as the Goldilocks zone because it's neither too hot nor too cold. Okay, so that's the habitable zone around the star. Okay, so there are now among the exoplanets that have been studied, there are potentially habitable exoplanets, and a few of them are shown here. Okay, one can go and look at these details. So people have found that probably life could exist on these exoplanets because according to our calculations, these are within the habitable zone. Now we come to stars. Okay, from the planets, we move on to the objects hosting the planets, which are the stars. So as you look up the night sky, you see a large number of stars, isn't it? You see them, they appear, some are bright, some are faint. They seem to have different colors. So what essentially is a star? Okay, that's the first question that we need to ask. Okay, so this is of course a picture of our sun. And so star is an entity which is bound by self-gravity. That means it is held together by self-gravity. That is why it is spherical in shape, because gravitational force is a radial force. So because of which it is mostly spherical. There are cases where they need not be spherical because of rotation, magnetic field and so on. But let us for the moment ignore them or assume that they are negligible. And in that case, it will be spherical. Secondly, they radiate in energy from an internal source. So the star is a source of energy. Mostly it is nuclear energy. There are cases in which there are other forms of energy which is generated in stars, within some kinds of stars. But for now, let us restrict us to those cases where the internal source of energy is the nuclear energy. So if you assume that these two define a star, then obviously from this definition, planets, asteroids, and comets, they do not satisfy one or more conditions. For example, planets are spherical, but they do not have an internal source of energy. They actually radiate energy. They do have some amount of radioactive energy, but we do not consider them star. Very teeny weeny bit. Now, asteroids and comets, of course, are not spherical either. Now, among the stars, our star is the sun, which can be studied in great detail. In fact, the sun, because of its proximity, we have been able to understand a lot about stars using our sun as an example. And then we use it because of this very detailed study, we speculate that similar things must be happening in other stars of similar masses, and therefore then scale according to if it's heavier, what would happen, or if it's lighter, what would happen, and so on. And what is the nearest star after the sun? Our next nearest star is the Proxima Centauri, which is around 4.2 light years away. And in our galaxy, as I said, we've already discussed briefly what is a galaxy. It's a large group of stars. There are nearly about, it is estimated that there are nearly 100 to 400 billion stars in the Milky Way. Now, these are statistical estimates that people have got of the number of stars which are present in our galaxy. So what is the chemical composition of stars? Is it the same as what you see on Earth, on the planet? So the chemical composition of most stars is similar to the chemical composition of most of the star, not at the center. At the very center, there's nuclear processing going on, but most of the star is similar to what is there in the universe as such, which is mostly hydrogen and helium. So here, for example, is shown a pie chart showing the composition of cosmic objects in the universe. Typical, it is not necessary everywhere, all the cosmic objects will have exactly the same, but this is more or less typically representative of the chemical composition in cosmic objects. So most, suppose you take 10,000, then 7,500 parts out of 10,000, or basically essentially 75% of the star is made up of hydrogen, and then you have 23%, which is helium, and then you have next is oxygen, then which is 100 out of 10,000. And then you have carbon. So after hydrogen and helium, you have oxygen and carbon in abundance. And then you have all these other elements, which is neon, iron, nitrogen, silicon, magnesium, and so on. In fact, all these have been produced in the interior of stars themselves. And they are distributed now everywhere in the most of the places in the galaxy, for example. One thing I would like to mention is very often astronomers use some jargon. Okay, so I will just introduce you to some more jargon. Very often astronomers use any element heavier than hydrogen and helium, they refer to it as a metal. We all know that from what we know of metal, they have some very specific properties, right, on Earth that they should they have free electrons, for example, and high conductivity electrical and thermal and so on. But this is not the definition which is used by astronomers. Astronomers use the term metallicity very loosely, metals very loosely. We use the term metals for all the elements which are heavier than hydrogen and helium. That is also because in outer space you do not have you have very rare, in the sense the density is so low that even if these elements are present, they will be present as atoms or ions and so on. And the smallest particles will be maybe 9 micron size that you can see in space as such. Okay, now coming to the energy generation in stars. So as we have been talking, nuclear fusion is the main source of energy in stars. And these are and the stars which generate energy by nuclear fusion of hydrogen to helium, okay, because hydrogen is the most abundant element, and the temperatures in the core of stars can be such that fusion of hydrogen to helium can be initiated. We will be looking at these reactions in more detail as we go along, but this is an introductory lecture. So it is good to know that the fusion of hydrogen to helium is the source of energy in most of the stars. And these stars in particular are called as main sequence stars. So main sequence stars are those where the source of energy is nuclear fusion, in particular fusion of hydrogen to helium. Second thing I want to emphasize is that this fusion doesn't happen throughout the star. It happens only in the very core where the temperature and pressure are high enough for these reactions to occur. It doesn't occur on the surface or near the surface. It happens roughly within 10% of the radius or very near the core where the temperatures are very high. Because all of you may be aware that to have fusion reactions, you really need very high temperatures. Now, when you look up at the sky, then you see, you try to understand certain region of skies by looking at patterns in the sky, right? Many of you may be familiar with these patterns. These are known as constellations. So the constellations are the patterns of, I would not call it groups of stars, rather I will call it the pattern or the design of stars which is in the sky. So, of course, in ancient times, there is also a rich tradition regarding these constellations, right? Because in ancient times, there were mythological creatures which were associated with these constellations, okay? And it, of course, it refers to the brightest stars that appeared to be projected in group, okay? And many of you may be familiar with quite a few names of these constellations. This is very culture intensive in the sense that different cultures have different names and different stories about these constellations. So for example, this is one constellation which is visible over India throughout most of the year. And you can very easily identify this because of these three stars at the center and this pattern here. So this is the Orion constellation. Okay, and if you do look up at the night sky sometime, maybe tonight, maybe when your sky is clear, for example, then you, if you're able to locate this constellation, do not forget to miss out this very interesting region. This is a nebula called M42, and this is where stars are being formed. Okay, so this is also visible very faintly with the naked eye. You can see this. So this, of course, can be seen with the naked eye. So very often, just now I showed you some pictures, right, which were where lines were connected. Of course, you can't see lines in the sky. These are imaginary lines. Okay, I want to emphasize, and that's why I've just drawn these lines to show you what the Orion constellation would look like. So Orion means a hunter, and this is the how the hunter is. This is the body of the hunter. This is the belt. This is the belt, Orion belt. This is the sword and so on. Now in a constellation, we can identify stars which are the brightest in that constellation. So they are in the constellation. If you want to identify stars and talk to your friends about it, then you will use the terminology alpha, beta, gamma and so on. So if it is the brightest star in the constellation, it will be called alpha and the constellation name you're given with it. the possessive form of the name. For example, in the Orion constellation, this star is the brightest in the Orion constellation, and it is actually Betelgeuse. You may have heard of this. And this is known as Alpha Orionis. And this star is the second brightest according to what we see, the light, the naked eye, as we are seeing the naked or with telescope and so on, based on the light that is received here. This seems brightest than this. This is Rigel, also known as Beta Orionis. Similarly, you'll have Gamma Orionis, Delta Orionis, and so on. You can have this for any constellation. You can find the brightest star will have alpha in the possessive form of that constellation name. Okay, it is very important to know, for example, that the stars of a constellation, they need not be at the same distance. In fact, very often they are not at same distance from us. When we look at the sky, everything appears to be in projection, correct? But actual distance to these stars, we cannot make out. Okay, so star which may appear fainter may actually be a inherently brighter star, but it is at farther distance from us. And a star which appears brighter in a constellation can be a close by star, correct? So therefore, it is important to know that all the constellations are, that's why I refer to them as patterns in the sky. Okay, they only appear to be close to one another in the sky. Okay, usually this is only because of projection, but in reality, the distances from us could be very different. Okay, so for example, here is shown the Orion, just as a schematic is shown that if you have light bulbs at different distances, but you are seeing in projection, you will see something like this, but in reality, they're actually at different distances from you. Similarly here. So I have another picture to show this to you. So here is showing you here, this picture actually shows the distances. What are the typical values of the distance of Orion, for example? So here is a Betelgeuse. Can you please mute? Yeah, somebody's mic is on. Can you please mute?
Yes, done.
Yeah, okay. So here is Betelgeuse, for example. It is at a distance of 640 light years away, and it is the bright. It appears the brightest to us. Inherently, it is bright, and the distance effect. Both these go into deciding what is the light that we are receiving from the star and how bright it appears to us. And here are the other stars. For example, this is the Orion belt that you see. Here is Rigel, for example. Then you have other stars, Bellatrix, and then you have the Orion Nebula, which I called the M42 just now. But in projection, you will see them all like this. In reality, stars in a constellation are at very different distances from us and not part of the same. Now, just this is what I wanted to say, that when you look up at the sky, everything seems to be in projection. Correct. So it appears like a big dome. Like if you look at the sky and you're looking in all directions, it appears like a big, a very huge dome. Okay, sky as a dome. That's why when you go to the planetarium, it is a very close representation of what you see in the sky, because there it's like a dome. And actually, it appears like a sky to you. So we will be coming back to this concept of sky as a dome very soon in order to understand the motion of the stars in the sky. But this point right above us is known as the zenith on your sky. Okay, we'll be coming back to this. And this, whatever till the farthest distance you see, that is known as the horizon. And I'm sure all of you have heard of horizon, correct? Now, how do we measure distances of between stars in the sky? The stars as such, because now, first of all, we will not be looking at stars as if in space, 3D space. We will rather look at them as projection, because that is how it appears to us. Okay, in the first instance. Then we will be later stage talking about distance, actual spatial distance in the sky, which is at closer distance to us in parsec, which is at further distance, that we will see later. But when you really look up at stars in the night sky, all of them are in a kind of projection onto this dome. Correct. And suppose you want to measure, there are two stars and you want to measure the separation between them. So this star, because it is a dome, you can think of it as a projection, you can measure the separation between the stars. Or suppose you have a galaxy, for example, which you can see, then you can measure the size of a galaxy in projection in terms of angles. So separations on sky are measured as angles. So what are the units of angles? I'm sure all of you know. Units of angles could be degrees. They could also be radians, correct? So 1 degree is, we look at very small separations between stars, we look at units which are smaller than 1 degree also. So 1 degree is equal to 60 arc minute. So arc minute is shown by this small apostrophe on top. And 1 arc minute is equal to 60 arc second. So arc second is denoted by this. Two apostrophes on top. So therefore, 1 degree is equal to 3600 arc seconds. So this is because we, as astronomers, we need to find out the smallest distances between objects. And these are the smallest units that are considered. And if you want to go even smaller, then we usually use milli arc seconds and so on. But typically, these are the units that astronomers use to measure separation between objects: degrees, arc minutes, and arc seconds. Now, typically, what is the size of the sun and moon? So if you look at the sun and the moon during solar eclipse, they appear to be same size. We know in reality they are very different sizes, but they appear to be of the same size to us, correct? Because of their distance is compensated by the size. So the angular size of the sun and moon are very similar because it fully covers, moon seems to fully cover the sun. So this size is of the order of 0.5 degrees, okay? And it is also important to know how to convert from radians to degrees and vice versa. So let me just show this to you. So as I said, 1 degree is equal to 60 arc minute and 1 arc minute is equal to 60 arc second. Now, you can all, this is of course degree, arc minute, arc second, but you can also have radian, okay? So pi radian is equal to 180 degrees. I'm sure all of you know that. So if you want to write the conversion between radians and degree, therefore you have 1 radian is equal to 180 degrees by pi, correct? So if you want to convert between radians and degrees, this is how we choose, and pi value all of you know. Correct. So suppose I want to know 1 radian is how many arc second, correct? So how will I do the conversion? 1 radian is equal to 180 by pi, but 180 degrees is 60 arc minute into 60 arc second. So if you will calculate arc second, so this is actually in units of arc second. So if you calculate, you will find it is of the order of 206-265. I urge all of you to do this calculation. So 1 radian is typically 206-265 arc second. Now, why do you say, let us not worry about radians at all? No, we will need to worry about radians, as we will see soon enough. But 1 radian, if you want to convert to arc second, it is 206-265. And if you want to convert to degrees, then 1 radian is equal to 180 by pi degrees. Okay, so let me go back. Let me just find out where was I. Okay. Why am I not able to go? Okay, I will work with this as such for now, and later I will see why we are not able to do this. Okay, so the angles are measured in between radians, conversion from degrees to radians and vice versa, now we have seen. Now, very often in the sky, the angles are very, very small. Okay, for example, the angle that you measure, since they are very small, I can make certain approximation. That is known as a small angle approximation. So for example, you have 2 stars which are at physical separation of S, and both are at same distance D from us. I am the observer O here. So I am looking at two stars in the sky, which has a small separation of certain theta arc minute. And if this theta arc minute, so arc minute is very small, as you realize now. So I can make some useful approximations. And this useful approximation is that I can assume both stars to be at similar distance from us because the angle is very small. Both are at similar distance from us. And then I can use this approximation where sine theta is almost equivalent to theta. Now, when I say sine theta is almost equivalent to theta, this is for radians. Or tan theta is almost equivalent to theta is equal for radians. I cannot call one arc minute and then put one arc minute here. So in fact, I urge you to go and check this out. So suppose you consider 1 arc minute, then you calculate for 1 arc minute, what is sine of 1 arc minute, that is sine of 1 by 60 degrees, and calculate that value in radians, and you will find that it is actually very close. Okay, so this is a small angle approximation which is used, and by using this, I can actually, for example, get the physical separation between stars. Because once I know sine theta is almost equivalent to theta, then I can say that my S is equal to d theta. I can either call it S is equal to d tan theta or d sine theta, but since sine theta or tan theta are similar, therefore I can write S as d theta. In radians, mind you, where theta is in radians. So if two stars are at similar distance and angular separation is known, then I can use this. So this is, for example, shown here. If you are having one star here, and this is where I am located. For example, this is my eye. Then if the distance to both of them is nearly d, I can make this approximation because the angle is really very small and they are at same distance from us. If they are at different distance, then that then it will become a different, you have to use a different mathematical formula, right? If the distances are different, then you cannot use this. This you can use only if they are at same distance from us. So sine theta is almost equal to theta, which is equal to s by d, which is equal to almost equal to tan theta. So you can calculate the physical separation between two stars by using this simple small angle approximation formula. For example, if you know the size of a nebula, right, in arc minute, correct? Some theta arc minute or whatever is the size. If the size is small, this approximation is valid. If the size starts becoming very large, then it will not be valid. So once you have this small size using small angle approximation, I can calculate the physical size of this nebula because this nebula is at the same, roughly at the same distance from us, isn't it? So if I know the distance to the nebula, then I can calculate the size of the nebula in parsecs or light years or astronomical units, whatever. Okay. Okay. So using this, we can actually define parsec. Okay, so parsec is that distance at which one arc second corresponds to one astronomical unit. Okay, so I want you all to do and confirm this calculation. At what distance or what value of the distance one astronomical unit will subtend an angle of one arc second? So my value of theta is in 1 arc second. Be sure to convert that to radians. And you have one astronomical unit whose value you already know, which is 1.5 10 power 11 meters. Using these two, calculate the value of d. And you will find that that comes out to be 1 parsec, which is of this 3.086 10 power 6, 16 meter. All of you, please work this out. It is a very simple calculation using this. As I said, I emphasize again, please put theta in radians, okay? So now if you want to get an idea, for example, of the separation on the sky, or you want to measure in the sky, what is the separation between two stars? Really, we may not have a very good idea. We have an idea by looking at the size of the sun or moon, that half a degree. And therefore, if I have something which is double the size or twice the size of the sun or moon as we see it in the sky, that's roughly 1 degree and so on. But you can also use other simple rudimentary ways to get approximate angles in the sky. So suppose you extend your arm out, okay, and you are measuring between two stars, the distance, for example, is between, you have to extend your arm. This is very important. Huh? You cannot put your arm very close to your eye because if you keep your palm in front of your eye, you can't see anything. and everything will be covered, okay? But you have to extend your arm out as shown here in this figure. You should stretch out your arm, and suppose the two separation between two stars is between your thumb and your small finger, then that is typically 20 to 25 degrees. The angle which is subtended by one finger is roughly 1 degree, and by your fist is roughly 10 degrees. So do go out and try out and measure the angles between stars, okay? But you have to stretch it out, okay? Of course, these are just to give a rough idea of what are the typical angles like. Of course, they are not very accurate, but will give you a fairly good idea of the sky. Okay, and this, for example, shows the Dipper constellation. Big Dipper constellation, and this pole star, also known as Polaris, the angles between them. Okay, so you must, if you are able to see this Big Dipper from your location at night, please go out, look at the constellations, try to measure angles, and be very much a part of the stars that you are seeing in the sky. Try to measure this angle. This is typically 25 degrees, this is typically 15 degrees, and this is roughly 10 degrees. Okay, this is 5 degrees, and between this star and the Polaris, because Polaris is a part of the Ursa Minor, then this is typically of the order of 28 degrees. Now, this is the constellations as we know. Culturally, traditionally, we have some constellations, but the International Astronomical Union, that decided to divide the sky into 88 constellations. Okay, so the entire sky, now you'll say, how did you bring the sky in terms of a rectangle? Okay, we have done this because of a certain projection which is known as cylindrical projection. It's like you put a paper cylinder around your globe and then open it out. Okay, so it won't exactly be spherical in many senses. For example, all this corresponds to one point here and here and here. This distance will be smaller, and these at the equator it will be the largest. So basically, this kind of projection is known as a cylindrical projection. So if you make a cylindrical projection of the sky, this is what the sky will look like. For example, it has 88 constellations, and the IAU felt the need, International Astronomical Union felt the need to divide the sky, because suppose you want to talk about, very often amateur astronomers and a lot of people are familiar with constellations in the sky. Some of them are very well known, some of them are not so well known, and so on. So, If they are talking about some science that has been done, for example, some research towards a very interesting object, then what they usually do is they start by saying, look, that object that we are studying in, which is going into a supernova, is located in that region of the sky. So to pinpoint that region, they'll say it's located in that constellation region. So that was the reason for them to divide the sky into roughly these demarcations or constellations. This does not represent the patterns in the sky. These represent the divisions of the sky scientifically, as has been done by the International Astronomical Union. And these divisions include very often those constellations which we have seen just now. Okay, so the next question is, we will come back to stars soon. We will be talking a lot about them. So how are stars formed? Just a brief idea of how the stars are formed. So between the stars, is the space empty? That is, of course, the question that one wants to ask. So it so happens that the space, as you can see from this picture itself, it is very evident that the space between stars is not empty. Wait, I think I want to make this full screen, so I'll stop share for a moment and share again. Okay. It's still not possible. Okay, I guess we will go like this and I will try to figure out next time. Okay, so between the stars, there is this, as you can see, there is a lot of emission you can see, right? Something that you're familiar with in the form of nebulae. So what is it that it is giving off light like this? This is actually some gas which is present, and some small amount of dust which is present, very minute particles, not like the sand grains we see on Earth, but much, much smaller, submicron size, smaller than a micron also. Okay, so these particles comprise what is known as the interstellar medium. This is a medium between the stars. Okay, And it is from this medium that stars are formed. And when the stars have a finite lifetime, because they will, it's not that stars live indefinitely, as we have just seen, they burn, they undergo burn in the sense, not chemical burning, they undergo nuclear burning or nuclear fusion of hydrogen to helium and so on. And then there are some further nuclear processes, but there is a finite lifetime, because ultimately the condition, the material, which is the fuel, the nuclear fuel here also tends to get over. So stars also have a finite lifetime. And after the star's lifetime is over, it can actually give off the material into the interstellar medium. That is how the mixing of material happens. And that is why elements, heavy elements, which are processed in the very core of the stars, they can get mixed with the surrounding interstellar medium. And from that medium, further new stars can be formed. So this process continues. So it is in this interstellar medium that the stars are formed. So it, as I said, these are nebulae, which are made up of gas and dust, which are integral part of the interstellar medium. And it is from this medium that stars are formed. So just to give you an idea, a very brief idea, you have this very cold nebula of gas and dust. It has to be really very cold, because if it is hotter, then it cannot undergo gravitational collapse. So it has to be very cold so that it undergoes collapse in the beginning. And as it undergoes collapse, there can be these regions of cores and clumps and so on, where there can be small individual entities which can undergo, because of the higher densities, they can go undergo collapse at a faster rate. And if the conditions are right enough, that at the center of these clumps and cores, nuclear fusion begins, then it is kind of the birth of a star. But this process is not very straightforward, which I have said in two sentences. It's a very long, drawn, elaborate process, but this is how typically how stars are formed. Usually when stars are formed, the cloud initially may be undergoing some small rotation, and therefore when it undergoes gravitational collapse, it becomes smaller in size. When it starts becoming smaller in size, it starts rotating at a rapid speed because of the rapid pace, because of the conservation of angular momentum. And as a result of this conservation of angular momentum, the material does not remain in the form of a nebula, rather it gets compressed to a form of a disk. So this disk is typically perpendicular to the rotation axis of the initial nebula or the stellar object. And over time in this disk, planets can form. So that over time, but there is a lot of gas and dust which is present initially. Over time, that gas and dust can either condense and quite emit, may escape the system. And this is how, this is what gives rise to a planetary system, where you have a star which is formed at the center, and around it you can have a planetary system. If you have ever wondered why most of the planets seem to be in a plane but not moving randomly about the sun, then this is the answer, because they formed in a disk. It is a disk in which these planets formed. And this disk represents the initial protostellar disk of the material from the nebula, which condensed to form a disk because of the rotation. Okay, so there are, of course, a lot of active research which is going on in trying to understand what gives rise to star formation. And this, for example, is some dense molecular clouds which has been imaged using the Hubble Space Telescopes, because they have pillar shape, and it is, these are very nebula here, the cold dust is, suppose there is radiation from nearby stars, it is protected in the centers in at the interior region of these pillars, you can have star formation occurring. That's why this picture has become very famous, because there is star formation happening in the interior. That's why it's known as pillars of creation. But always it need not be in the form of pillars, it can be in the form of spherical cores, clumps, and so on. Okay, so when a star is formed, usually it never forms alone. It is usually formed, for example, in groups, which is known as clusters. Now I am calling a star as a group, because whereas I did not do that for the constellation. So a stellar cluster represents groups of stars located at similar distance from us, because they are formed from the same molecular cloud, right? Or from the same nebula. okay, cold nebula, which I'm going to call molecular cloud, because the gas here is in the form of molecules because it's so cold. Okay, so these clusters are groups of stars located at same distance from us. They have similar chemical compositions because they are forming from same molecular cloud. And of course, they are distinct from constellation. By now, you must have realized, because in constellation, it's just a projection effect that we see stars which are at different distances. They seem to be arranged in a kind of pattern. Whereas a cluster is different. It's a group of stars formed from the same molecular cloud, having the same similar chemical composition and at similar distance from us. Now, we have seen how stars formed, we have seen what are stars, and now the question comes that, as I told sometime earlier, that what happens when stars finish hydrogen in their course. I think it is time we take a short break. So we'll take a short break of maybe 3 to 4 minutes, and then we will come back. Okay, so welcome back, and we can start again. Give me a moment. So I'll start my sharing of my screen. Okay, hopefully it will work now. Okay, so I hope you can see the full screen now.
Yes, madam.
Okay. So what happens when stars finish, main sequence stars? When I say stars, I mean main sequence stars, because we know the stars which are burning nuclear burning hydrogen to helium in their cores are known as main sequence stars. So what happens when main sequence stars finish burning or finish the hydrogen in their very cores, where the temperature is high enough for the nuclear fusion to occur? Outside that region, the temperature is not high enough, and therefore fusion is not occurring. So it so happens that the nuclear fusion will halt temporarily, and because of the nuclear fusion, actually the star was maintaining its shape, it was giving off energy and so on. But once that source of energy is over, then the star again begins its gravitational collapse. And at the core, what happens is, again, the temperature may rise high enough for helium to undergo nuclear fusion. Of course, it depends on the mass of the star and the temperature and which is achieved at the center and so on. So in principle, this process continues till either the temperature is not reached or there is no more mass that is left. So we will be talking about the evolution of stars. This is known as evolution of stars. What happens to the star at the end of its main sequence lifetime? And here we will be looking at some of the common evolutionary phases of stars. So here, this is common evolutionary phases for stars. This is just, as I said, this is an introductory lecture. We will be discussing these details later in the course of the lecture series. This is just to intimate or introduce you to various terms. We will be talking about these things again as we go along. So this is the cloud, nebular cloud, from which stars are formed, and the evolution of star depends on its mass. Generally, they are broadly categorized into two kinds: low mass stars and high mass stars. So low mass stars are stars like the sun, for example, of mass one solar mass, whereas the high mass stars are stars which are more than 8 to 10 times the mass of the sun. So I'll just show you, it so happens that for low mass stars, this is the typical evolutionary sequence. Of course, even in this, there is a range of masses. So there are slight differences in the way it approaches to the final stage, but this is just a broad categorization. For now, I think this is sufficient. So for low mass stars, this is the process by which stars are being formed. This is the star in the main sequence phase, like the sun. And this is, of course, after the sun, this is after the main sequence phase is over. There is a phase where the sun, the outer layers of the sun, outer layers of the star start expanding. And because of this expansion, the temperature at the outermost layers reduces and it starts appearing reddish. That is known as red giant. So the next phase would be the red giant phase, and an even later evolutionary phase is that these layers, outer layers, because they are expanding and the gravity is now lower, they can be thrown off the outer layers, and it forms a something known as a planetary nebula, where at the center you have the core and then you have most of the outer layers which are given off in the form of a planetary nebula. So these outer layers, when they are given off, they are still very hot and they are trying to mix with the surrounding interstellar medium, and they give rise to very dramatic shapes, as we will see shortly. And what is left at the core, there is no more nuclear fusion reaction occurring. That is known as a white dwarf. So this is like a hot matter which is present, and this is not undergoing collapsing under gravity. There is a certain pressure which is keeping it at its shape, and this is just hot because of the huge amount of energy that is present in it because of the previous fusion reactions that was occurring. And over time, this hot dwarf will just cool off slowly, slowly, slowly. It cools off. It's like a very hot iron ball you just keep somewhere. It's not iron, of course. It is in a case of white dwarf. It is other material which is present. It could be hydrogen, helium, and so on. There could be some amount of hydrogen on the surface. It could be mostly carbon or helium or oxygen, but it's not iron, in particular in white dwarfs. And if it is a very massive star, then it gives rise to the main sequence phase, massive stars. The mass of a star is a very important parameter during its evolution and how it evolves. Okay, and the properties are also largely dependent on the mass of the star. So this, for example, is a heavier main sequence star. And over time, after the hydrogen in the core is over, it instead of becoming a red giant, it becomes a huge red supergiant. Okay, and over time, whereas at the core, the nuclear fusion reactions keep continuing to happen and the outer layers are expanding. But the nuclear fusion reactions and other processes that occur at the center are such that it leads at a certain stage occurs where it leads to a huge explosion. And that in that explosion, the outer layers are thrown out. This doesn't happen here. Here they are thrown out slowly over time, whereas this is a very violent explosion or a very short time scale. That's known as a supernova. So a supernova therefore occurs for stars whose main sequence mass is greater than 8 to 10 times the mass of the sun. And what is where the outer layers are thrown out into the medium in the violent explosion, and what is left at the center can either be a neutron star or a black hole. Okay, so a neutron star is a very exotic star, mostly made up of neutrons, and all of you are very familiar with what a black hole is. We will not be talking about these details here anymore, but maybe in later stages we can touch upon these concepts in the later lectures. So what I will do now is I will show you some pictures of planetary nebula, for example, and supernova explosion, how it looks in the sky. So these are actual pictures taken by Hubble Space Telescope. Of course, the colors here need not be the actual colors. Sometimes this just represents certain wavelength of light, and astronomers give certain colors to certain wavelength. It may not actually represent pink here. It may or may not. It depends on how the astronomer is dealing with the image. Okay, so it could be a false color image or it could be a real color image. Okay, so if it is a false color image, it shows basically it shows that what you are seeing at pink pink here corresponds to a certain wavelength, and what you are seeing in blue corresponds to another wavelength. Okay, so this is an example of a planetary nebula, and you can see that it appears to be like a lot of mass is thrown out. But these explosions are not, these are not explosions. This happens over time and slowly. So here are shown different types of planetary nebula. These are some of the spectacularly beautiful objects in the sky. And these are some of the planetary nebula observed with the Hubble Space Telescope. As you can see, one of the characteristics of these nebula are they have very, very quite symmetric shapes. Okay, so people have tried to understand the symmetry, what gives rise to the symmetry. And very often you will see at the center that there is a bright object, that is the remnant white dwarf, which is left over after the processing is over, nuclear processing is over. Now, let us look at some pictures of supernova. This is, for example, the Crab supernova remnant. Now, supernova remnant doesn't mean the central object which is left over. Remnant means the outer, when the explosion happens, the outermost layers are thrown out. A lot of energy is given into the surrounding interstellar medium, which starts shining as brightly. And that is why you see this kind of structures which you see here. This is because of the energy which is given out. Violent amount of energy, huge amount of energy given off in a violent explosion. So this interstellar medium has starts lighting up because of the shocks that are driven into the medium. That is known as the supernova remnant. So this is a supernova remnant. At the center, you may or may not find. In many cases, people have found the progenitor. That means the object which gave rise to the supernova. That's called the progenitor. As we discussed, it can be a neutron star or it can be a black hole. In particularly in case of Crab, this at the center, they have found a pulsar. We have imaged it very well in X-ray, where you can see the pulsar very clearly. Or it could be a black hole also. So these are some of the supernova remnants. As I said, they are most bright in X-rays because a lot of energy is given off. And when they give off a lot of energy, they are brighter in X-rays than they would be in optical. And or it depends on the way the energy is being processed by the remnant. And here are shown some examples of the various supernova remnants. The colors, as now you you will appreciate the fact that X-rays are something that we cannot see, then how is it that these images have colors? Again, it comes back to the false color images. Here, the blue, for example, are X-rays at higher energy. So we take an image in X-ray of higher energy, and we take another image in X-ray of different energy, and we take a third image in a third energy band. So you have these three images, you combine them together using different color schemes. Let's say you attribute lowest energy to the red color, you make it fully red color image, intensity variation, and you can make the other one blue color, you can make the third one green color, and so on. So you can combine them. And if you see some regions are only blue, that means that corresponds to that energy band where which you gave blue color to it. Okay, so they are known as the false color images. So if you see this, this does not mean that this is optical light. It can be, you have to see what energies this corresponds to and what the colors that are given to it correspond to what energy to get an idea of what you are seeing. Okay. And the most energetic processes will emit in X-rays and higher energies. So this is a chart of the historical supernovae that have been observed, for example, as we know it. Okay. Now we go to, briefly we will touch upon galaxies. Okay. So first is, how did we know that we are a part of a big galaxy? Now this is a very interesting question. And at this stage, we will just say that it all started with few people actually counting the stars. Now you say that's a very, very tough job. So, but this was some endeavors that people did take up. Some astronomers in the earlier time, example, Herschel and all did take up. And they found that the density of stars in certain regions of the sky was much higher than that in other regions. So this is the first model of the Milky Way according to the star count. Okay. Over time, people, so now when you are saying counting stars, of course, it depends on how much you can see. So they divided the sky into small square boxes, and every night you would sit and count in certain boxes and so on. And over time, with improvement in telescope technology and so on, they were able to do a better job, do some estimates of calculations till what brightness we can see, what kind of stars we are missing out, what kind of stars we are seeing, what wavelength we are seeing. And they came up with better and better models of the Milky Way. So this, I will not go into details, but this is our current understanding of what a Milky Way is. So if you look at our Milky Way from the side, it would look like something like this, for example. So this is the center of the Milky Way. So where is Sun and the solar system? So the entire Milky Way is of the order of 80,000 to 100,000 light years. The center of Milky Way is here, and there is a supermassive black hole which is sitting at the center of the Milky Way. And you know that last year's Nobel Prize was given for this, for understanding of black holes and the experimental detection of black holes in our galaxy, for example. Then you have the Sun, which is in the disk. So it is something like a disk, and towards the center there is a bulge. So we are in the disk of the Milky Way, roughly 25,000 light years from the center. Okay. Now this is what, and of course there is a lot of other objects here, for example, globular clusters and so on. And this is the side view. If you're seeing from the side, this is, of course, I'm going outside the galaxy and seeing. It would appear like this. That's why this is an artistic representation. It's not an actual picture, because we cannot go outside our galaxy and take these pictures. This is just an artistic representation of what of a galaxy would look like. And suppose you decided to see from top, let's say from this direction, then it would appear to be something like this. This is the center, and it would seem to have various spiral arms, like a charkha, for example, or that cracker you're familiar with, right? So it would have spiral arms like this, different arms are there, and the Sun is in one of the arms. So this is what the Milky Way typically appears. We think the model of the Milky Way is something which is close to this. Now, are there other types of galaxies? Or all galaxies of the type that Milky Way is. It so happens that when you start looking at the sky, you start seeing that there are other types of galaxies also. Okay, in fact, the first of the doubts that people had were whether these other objects that they were seeing, whether they were part of our galaxy or whether they were part of other, they were outside our set of stars and so on. And over time, they established that these are different galaxies, which is of course outside the Milky Way. So galaxies broadly can be categorized into three types. One are spiral galaxies, then there are which have the spiral arms like this, and from the side they will have a disc kind structure. If you look at the side, as we have seen, very similar to what the Milky Way is. And then you could have these elliptical galaxies. Now these elliptical galaxies are 3D obloids, okay, or proloids you can call them. So these elliptical galaxies have a more continuous brightness distribution. So you can't see structures, very clear structures like this. They don't have a very flattened shape. Spiral galaxies, as we have seen, have kind of flattened shape, which is not true for elliptical galaxies. They are more like egg shaped and so on. Egg is not very symmetrical, but you can imagine symmetrical ovals and with 3D ovals. And then there are these categories which are known as irregular galaxies, which you can't really categorize into spiral type and elliptical type. So people are trying to understand the properties of these galaxies, how they were formed, why they are in their particular shape now, what are the characteristics of stars in these galaxies, and so on. So this is one region of the sky, for example, where you can see different galaxy types, a large number of galaxy types. So this, for example, with this, for example, is one image, recent image of the black hole, which was taken in radio waves by a huge consortium of astronomers using the Event Horizon called the Event Horizon Telescope Collaboration. And this was the image of a black hole that they took. But this is a black hole, which is not the black hole that we talked about, which is formed at the end of a stellar evolution. But this is rather a supermassive black hole, which is at the center of a galaxy, elliptical galaxy called M87. So this is much, much more massive. Okay, the supermassive black hole is, these black holes are much more heavier in mass than what is the small black hole which we have seen, which is at the end of stellar evolution called the stellar mass black hole. The supermassive black holes are found in the centers of most galaxies. And the while there was a lot of theory about it, for the first time an image was created. So what you see here is actually the disk around the, is the emission from a accretion disk around the black hole. And there also, because of rotation, there is a disk around the black hole which is giving off the emission. Okay, so with this, for today's lecture, I am at the end, but I will briefly talk a little bit about what astronomers or astrophysicists do, just to familiarize to you what is the kind of work we do. And of course, why we do is because we like to do, we love to do, understand more about the stars and galaxies. So for example, astronomers, usually broadly, people who work in astronomy, astrophysics, they usually do three kinds of work. One, of course, is doing observations. So nowadays, when we talk of observations, we can have our own small telescopes and look at it, look at objects in the sky. But if you want to really look at minute details or understand more deeply, then you need very large telescopes. And these large telescopes are national facilities. Sometimes many countries come together and build these telescopes. So these if we want to work with observations from these telescopes, then it is not that it can be handled by us. Since these are large facilities, there are actually a group of people who are working maintain the telescope and help observers, astronomical observers, with the observations, because it's a very large facility. So very often one goes, takes the observations from these telescopes. Typically one has to write proposals which are accepted, and then we are given some time for observing. We have to justify why we want to observe a region of the sky. And then once you go and observe, you may go or may not go to observe. Very often it is encouraged you go to the telescope and observe. Then you get your images. These images are, of course, nowadays digital images. And you take these images and you, in the computer, using various astronomical softwares, we analyze these images, look at them carefully, look at them at different wavelength bands, look at the brightness distributions, look at various aspects of these images and try to understand more about stars, galaxies. Then there is these, you can also do theory where based on observations, you can actually come up with theories as to why we are seeing what we are seeing based on the fundamental physics that we know. Okay, so you can venture into that area where you are actually, but of course, theory by itself has no meaning unless it is constrained by observations. So theory and observations have to go hand in hand for the furtherance of astronomy. Then there is also another class of astronomers who are very instrumental in the advancement of astronomy, which is the set of people who do instrumentation for the telescopes. So the building of the telescopes is done by a set of engineers and engineers with the help of astronomers, but there is also this group, but just telescopes is not enough because telescope is just a light gathering instrument. You need to take this light and analyze it. Either you may need to make an image or you need to disperse the light to get the spectrum. So for these, you have to build instruments at the focus of the telescope to do this further imaging or spectroscopy as it is called. And this is where the instrumentation people come in. So they are very good at building these instruments, and without the building and calibrating and testing these instruments, and without these instruments, without this set of people, it's not possible to observe with these instruments and telescopes. So broadly, this is the arena in which astronomers and astrophysicists work. So as I mentioned, now we have very large telescopes. These are some examples of the telescopes that are shown here. It's shown ALMA. Then you have there are large telescopes, ALMA. These are the radio telescope. ALMA is also radio telescopes. You have large binocular telescope. You have Keck telescope. You have very large telescope. There are a very large number of telescopes coming, which are present, 10 meter class in optical, and even larger are being built now. But as we have seen, the observations need not be restricted only to the visible wavelength band. You can also take images in other wavelength band, for example, in X-ray or in radio and so on, in infrared, ultraviolet, radio waves, X-rays. So we can have images taken in different wavelength band. And this is very evident by looking at this image. For example, Crabbe supernova remnant we have seen. Right? So this is the image in optical light. This is how it looks. And if you look at Crabbe nebula in infrared, it looks different. So does it in radio, as you can see here. In ultraviolet, this is how it looks. In X-ray, you can see the central pulsar here very clearly. And then in gamma rays only, very high energies, you see only coming from very close to the pulsar. So you see that at different wavelength bands, we get complementary information. And using the physics we know, we try to understand what is giving rise to the emission in a particular wavelength band based on the physical processes that we think could be giving rise to this emission. So it is important not only to study the sky in optical, but also in different wavelength bands in order to get a complete understanding of the cosmic objects. So we do observations not only from ground, but in some wavelength bands, you can't do them from the ground. So you do need to go to space. So what's the difference? Because from ground, if you do observations, the atmosphere sometimes in optical is not, it can be a problem, but we find ways to overcome it. But in other wavelength bands, for example, X-rays, gamma rays, and certain infrared wavelength bands, the light does not reach the ground. It is all absorbed by the atmosphere. So in those wavelength bands, it is best to go above the atmosphere and carry out observations. So there are a large number of space-based telescopes which actually carry out these observations. And work is going on and further work is going on even currently to send out these missions to space in order to gain a further understanding. So if you are interested, you may say some of you are young students here and are probably interested in astronomy, astrophysics. So I'll just give very briefly that if you are interested in astronomy, are in school now, and you want to make astronomy as your career, then typically this is a branch of physics, so you need to study physics. You need to have good sound basics in physics and maths. You can do a bachelor's program and a master's programs in physics. Physics typically essentially. But it is not really limited. There are cases where people from maths background or engineering background have also studied physics, for example, on their own and then moved to astronomy PhD. And to get a flavor, for example, you could do internships in various institutes, or there are visiting student programs to familiarize students more about astronomy, astrophysics by various institutes. And if you are interested, you can actually do a small project there to get more familiar with the concepts in astronomy and astrophysics. And if you're interested in making this as a career, then you need to have a PhD and you can enroll for the PhD either in India or abroad. And this is usually done through fellowships where you are supported through the fellowship programs. Then following the PhD, with the successful completion of a PhD, typically we do some independent research and for a few years using the postdoctoral program, okay, where you can be associated or with somebody, or you can do on your own independent research in this postdoctoral program. And as a career, very often, most astronomers take up academic positions in university or research institution to make it as a career. And this is need not be the only path. The skills you have learned can also be used either in industry or in a space agency. But if it is not a career yet, then all is not lost. You can still do it out of your interest or hobby by becoming an amateur astronomer. You can go and observe on your own. Many discoveries, as Professor Soumitra pointed out, have been made by amateur astronomers. So you can go and go out and observe the skies and learn more about it. Another thing that you can do is you can participate in something called citizen science projects. Okay, so there are certain websites where researchers want a lot of help from people. So they will, because there's a lot of data that is coming in from large telescopes and so on, but they don't have enough manpower to analyze these data. So that is when they offer it as a citizen science project where they train you. So once you enroll yourself in such a project, they will train you for a brief time so that about what is expected in the project. For example, it could be identification of galaxies, it could be search for planets, it could be maybe sometimes it could also be taking down some notes about something. So in this way, your interest about learning astronomy and using it and learning more can be furthered, even though you are not you have not taken it up as a career. There are now, of course, there are a lot of citizen science projects in this website, for example, astronomy projects, but now even in India, a few citizen science projects have started. So this is a good avenue to get, for example, engaged with astronomy in India. So with this, I come to the end of the first in the lecture series and first week in the lecture series. Some I have listed here some of the resources, that is the books and website that will be useful as we go along. I'm just listing them out here. I will not be listing in every lecture, but it may be good if you can get hold of these books, for example, and read them up while taking these courses. Okay. For example, there's a nice book, Fundamental Astronomy by Karthunan. Then Astronomy Principles and Practice by Roy and Clark. There's Gregory and Zelick and Carol and Osley. The last two are a little advanced as compared to this, but if you are inclined and interested, definitely you should go and have a look. And finally, there is this Encyclopedia of Astronomy and Astrophysics, where most of the topics are very well explained from the basic level to a very advanced level. And if you are interested, do go and check them out. So with this, I come to the end of the presentation for today. And I will see if I can answer a few questions now. I will look them up in the chat and I will answer them. So one of the questions, I will answer the relevant ones here and few within the time frames that we have. So one of the questions here is that we can measure length in kilometers. Why is it necessary? Is it really necessary to use AU? No, it is not necessary to use AU. You can continue measuring length in kilometers, but every time you will be writing 10 power 11 kilometers, 10 power 16 kilometers. Instead of that, if you have an idea of AU, the numbers start becoming smaller, 10,000 AU, 5,000 AU. So that gives you a scale. Because when you say 5,000 AU, you know roughly it is 5,000 times the distance between sun and earth. So that's the reason why we decide to go with AU. It's not wrong to use kilometers. Okay. Okay, there's this other question as how is the sun's mass calculated and how accurate is that? It's pretty accurate, okay? And you can use simple Newtonian laws to calculate the mass of the sun because we know that the earth is going around the sun, that the center, you can equate the gravitational force to the centripetal force. And once you equate that, you will get the mass of the sun in terms of the velocity. Of course, here we are here we are assuming that the sun, of course, is the center of the solar system. So even although the sun and earth form a binary, we are assuming that the sun, center of mass of the system is at the center of sun. So when you do this exercise, you can get the mass of the sun in terms of the velocity, the distance between the sun and earth, and a gravitational constant. So you get, that's a pretty accurate estimate that we have. Okay. Now I go to the next question. Can the structure of any constellation change over large time because of their motion? Okay, so as I said, in case some of the questions that have been asked in the earlier stages probably have been answered later. So any of these things I will not go through. So coming to this question, when you say large time, how large time? That is important. Everything is actually relative with respect to that. So when we are talking about, so this question is not very clear, but we are saying that stars can move. So we need to understand motion of stars. Do stars move? How do stars move? And what are the time scales over which they move? What are the motions they can have and so on? So that is related to motion of stars. And we will be covering that in the next lecture, couple of lectures next week. Let me just quickly check what are the other questions that are there. Okay, so the questions which are related to some of the things I mentioned, we will be coming back to them. And I must also remind that these can, some of the things I said can go to very advanced concepts. Since we have a varied level of students, I will not be going into too intricate in details, too much level in details. Okay, for example, why isn't gravitational pull not prominent in white dwarf? It's not that gravitational pull is not there, it is there, but there is a different kind of pressure that is present in these systems because which can oppose or overcome this gravity. Okay, and that is why this happens. That's known as the degeneracy pressure, but we will not be going into details of those aspects or those concepts because we have a very varied range of level. As we said, this course is for 12th class and above. So I will try to answer those questions, which even a person who has finished plus two can understand. Okay, so somebody has asked, can PVTs be provided after the class end? It's not really necessary because I think this has been streamed on YouTube. So you can always go back and look at the lecture on YouTube. Okay, what is the application of radio astronomy in analyzing stars? Okay. So radio astronomy, as we have seen, multi-wavelength astronomy samples a certain processes which are very useful in understanding stars. So at this stage, this is all that I will say. I will try to take questions which are relevant to the theme for today's lecture. What is a pulsar and whether it is associated only with supernovae? So yes, a pulsar is associated with a supernova and it is something, it is a rapidly spinning neutron star. Okay, it is known as pulsar because it gives off radiation from the, because it's spinning, it has a certain rotation axis and along the poles of the rotation axis, it can give off light. If that is within your field of view, if that rotation axis is within the field of view while it is spinning, you will see light coming out as pulses, more like lighthouse. That is why it is known as a pulsar. So a pulsar is essentially a rotating neutron star. what are the engineering challenges in analyzing stars? Okay, so this I think also partly I have answered. The engineering challenges comes in building the instruments and in building the telescopes and the associated electronics of that. So there are a number of engineers who have contributed immensely in building of not only radio telescopes, but also the instruments in different wavelength bands. And particularly in radio telescopes, mostly it is done through the radio signals are analyzed through voltages and the power that is measured. So they have a large role to play there. Okay. Okay. Which type of galaxy is ours? I think we have answered this. Okay, this is another question which we will answer in the next lecture series. Would the sky look different from India compared to where I live in Australia? Yes, it will look very different. In fact, different locations within Australia and different locations within India will also be very different. And this is what we will be covering in the next lecture, how your sky looks from your position, and you can tell so how it will look from some other position. Okay, so in the next lecture we will be covering this specifically about the motion of stars and how the sky looks different in different positions. Okay, why planets always form round in shape and galaxies form in disc shape? Firstly, they are very, very different structures. Planets are very small entities, and where the spinning is not so important, of course, and they are rocky, let us say, or even if they're not rocky, gassy or icy giants, because of the gravity and the gravitational interaction, they are spherical in shape. As I said, if gravity plays a very important role, then they will be spherical in shape, provided the rotation is not very important of this object. But if rotation starts playing a very important role, then matter can start settling in the form of a disk. And that is why the presence of rotation is what decides the shape. For example, even in the case of Earth, you know, it's not exactly spherical. There's a slight bulge towards the equator. And this is because of the rotation of Earth. So this shape is entirely decided by gravity vis-a-vis rotation. Can we do PhD in astrophysics after MSc in physics? Yes, definitely that can be done, as I have explained this. Okay. All right. I think these are the classes. Do we know by any chance some question has just come now? This is the last question I will take. Do we know why there is a black hole at the center of every galaxy? Well, we don't know clearly the answer why it is there, but people are trying to find out. It has to do with what happened very early in time in the cosmos. So people are trying to find that when the galaxy did this assemble over time, or whether they were there in the initial stages when the galaxies were formed. So answer is not yet clear to us, and astronomers are working on this to try and answer the very questions that you are asking. So with this, I think I will stop for today. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sarita, for this wonderful introductory class. Now we have a large number of questions posted in YouTube. We'll be taking them up later, and the answers will be definitely posted in YouTube, or we'll see how we can post this answers to these questions. Probably we can post this in our Moodle platform also. And all the students who have now confirmed their participation in the course will be enrolled in Moodle learning management systems, and you'll be getting the user ID and password of the Moodle LMS in few days. And please make sure that you are checking your emails regularly. And sometimes these mails can go to your other folders, like spam folder, social folder, or promotions folders. So please make sure that you are checking all these folders. If you don't get these emails in the main inbox of your you can say email account, and you have to make sure that we have already posted the link for marking the attendance in Zoom as well as YouTube. Please make sure that enrolled students have marked their attendance, and we will be also forming a Telegram group of all the enrolled participants of this course, and we'll also be sharing that link for joining this Telegram group. We'll email the link shortly. So I once again thank all the participants of this course. And we couldn't, of course, accommodate all the participants. We had thousands of registrations, and we have enrolled only the students above higher secondary level who are currently studying in doing different courses for this course. And others can definitely watch these lectures live in YouTube. And we have already recorded these videos, and videos are definitely available. It will be available in the YouTube channel. So thank you once again, and thank you, Professor Sarita, for taking your valuable time for offering a free lecture like this. And I hope that this will be immensely useful for large number of students. And we are very happy, indeed very happy, that we got tremendous response for this course. And we are sorry that we couldn't accommodate all of you for this course. So thank you very much, all the participants. Thank you once again, Professor Sarita. So we are ending this today's session here. Thank you.